What we often want to have for a complexity class is a problem in that class that really represents that class. So a problem which encapsulates the core features of that particular complexity class. And these are the complete problems for the class. For NP, the representative problem that's most often used for the class is satisfiability. That problem, satisfiability, really captures what NP is all about. So the question is, for P space, what is such a representative problem? And the answer is that most of the time, people use quantified satisfiability as the representative for that class. Quantified satisfiability is the following decision problem. The input is a Boolean CNF formula in n variables, phi of x1 to xn. The question is whether the following propositional formula is true. Does there exist an x1 such that for all x2, there exists an x3 such that for all x4, and so on, there exists an xn such that the formula is true? Here, I assume that n is odd. If n is even, then the quantifier in front of xn needs to be a universal quantifier, so we would have for all xn. But really, without loss of generality, we can just assume that n is odd. This might be a bit difficult to parse and to understand at first, so it might be helpful to look at this in a slightly different way. We can look at this problem as a game between two players. We have the existential player, let's call her Alice, and a universal player, let's call him Bob. And Alice picks values for the odd-numbered variables, x1, x3, x5, and so on. And Bob, the universal player, picks values for the variables x2, x4, x6, so all the even-numbered variables. And we have a game between Alice and Bob that works as follows. Alice starts to pick a value for x1, and then Bob responds by picking a value for x2. And then Alice, in turn, picks a value for x3, and so on. So Alice and Bob alternate in assigning values to the variables. And the goal of the existential player, of Alice, is to make the final formula true. So she tries to be clever about how she picks the values for x1, x3, and so on. Her goal is to make the formula true in the end. Bob's goal is to make the formula false, so he wants to prevent Alice from winning this game. So he picks the values for x2, x4, and so on in such a way that hopefully will make the formula false in the end. And the question now is whether Alice has a winning strategy in this game. Can Alice force the formula to be true in the end, no matter what Bob does? So here's an example of a Boolean CNF formula in three variables, x1 or x2, and x2 or not x3, and not x1 or not x2 or x3. So does Alice have a winning strategy here, or does Bob have? So here's a winning strategy for Alice. Alice can set the variable x1 to true. That's the first step. This already satisfies the first clause in this Boolean CNF formula. So Alice now only needs to satisfy the remaining two clauses. The second step is that Bob picks a value for x2. He can either set x2 to true or to false. Alice then responds by setting x3 to be the same value as x2. So if Bob sets x2 to false, Alice will set x3 to false as well. But if Bob sets x2 to true, then Alice will set x3 to true as well. And this will always make the formula true, because Look at the second clause here, which is x2 or not x3. If Bob sets x2 to true, that clause will be true. However, if Bob sets x2 to false, then Alice will set x3 to false as well, which also will make the second clause here true. And the third clause will also be true either way. If Bob sets x2 to false, then this third clause is already satisfied. But if Bob sets x2 to true, then x3 will be set to true as well by Alice, which will satisfy the third clause of the formula. So all three clauses of the formula will be satisfied in the end, will be true in the end, and therefore Alice can win this game following that specific strategy. So this was a specific example. In general, it's quite difficult to describe these strategies, in particular if you have many more than just three variables. But for this particular example, we could actually describe what Alice's strategy would be to win this particular game. So this would be a yes instance for quantified satisfiability. An example of a no instance for quantified satisfiability would be x1 or x2, and not x2 or not x3, and not x1 or not x2 or x3. It's quite difficult to see in general when a formula is a no instance, but here we can try to reason about it a little bit because it's a fairly small formula. So suppose Alice tries to set x1 to false, then what Bob can do is he can set x2 to false as well, which means it will become impossible to satisfy the first clause in this formula, which is x1 or x2. So this would just be false now. There are no further literals in that clause, so it will become impossible to make the formula true. Alice loses the game. So Alice has to set x1 to true. But if she sets x1 to true, Bob will set x2 to true as well. And the problem for Alice now is that if we look at the remaining two clauses, there are no good choices for her for the value of x3. If x2 is set to true, then the only way to satisfy the second clause of the formula is to set x3 to false. So that's what Alice would have to do. But if she sets x3 to false, let's look at the third clause of the formula. x1 is true, so that doesn't help for the third clause. x2 is true as well, which doesn't help for the clause. And x3 is now false, so the third clause of the formula would remain false, and therefore Alice loses the game. So no matter what she does, Bob can force a win for himself here. And therefore, this is an example of a no instance for quantified satisfiability.